Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Revelations by Jessica Meigs. Narrated by Shaina Summerville. From the Journal of Ethan Bennett, March 21st.
My name is Ethan Bennett, and I am a dead man. I officially died a month ago at the hands of a group of homicidal people infected with the Michaluk virus. I suffered serious injuries and contracted the virus while attempting to delay the infected attackers' pursuit of my friends. I was saved from succumbing to the virus by sheer luck, and with the help of a medication cocktail that holds the virus at bay. For now, I only have a low risk of becoming like those who killed me. For now. I'm with a group led by a woman named Alicia Day. She's former Marine Security Forces, and the people here seem to hold her in very high regard. She leads roughly 150 men, women, and children at the Westin. Through their hard work, they've turned this hotel into a small village. Around 30 of those people are infected with the virus in a manner similar to me. It's only through the miraculous chance of having a CDC doctor here that I'm able to write this. That the infected living here are able to continue with their lives, such as they are. Despite the daily medication regimen, they've eked out a reasonably productive existence in the hopes that something more permanent can one day be discovered. They live for that hope, though there's always the chance their bodies will hit the point where the medications are no longer effective. Alicia tells me it's imperative that we find Brandt Evans. He was one of my friends before I became infected, and I don't know where he is. I can't remember where any of my friends were to go after Atlanta. And honestly, that terrifies me. Because if what Alicia tells me about Brandt is even remotely true, then my best friend Cade and my lover Remy, and hell, even Gray, as much as I dislike the bastard, they're all in danger. If Brandt is infected, he poses a major risk not only to Cade, Gray, and Remy, but to the entire world. But Brandt Evans is also a hope, a possibility of a key to the cure for the Michaluk virus. And that is a chance we can't afford to let pass. Our bodies have begun to adjust and adapt to the medications. I'm fine for now, but there are many who aren't. The drugs are losing their effectiveness for some. There have already been 4 people to spontaneously fall ill this week alone. 4 people Alicia took away from the others and put down, as she said it was her responsibility to do. The survivors can't keep losing numbers like this. We need a cure, and we need it fast. And we're hoping Brandt Evans can give us one.
Chapter 1. Remy Angelette's nights had become filled with entirely too much coffee. That wasn't a good thing. The liquid, however dark and rich and deliciously bitter it was, kept her awake far more than she'd already been before the group's flight from Maplesville over a month ago. Her nerves jittered at the thought of them running out of the sparse supply of coffee grounds that they'd already been reduced to. But the sleeplessness caused by the caffeinated drink and her own willpower was far better than the nightmares that plagued her every time she closed her eyes. She wasn't sure if Brandt had caught on that she wasn't sleeping, but Gray definitely had. Oddly enough, he hadn't said anything to her about it. Instead, he'd often join her on the roof of their newest safe house late at night, and together they'd sit in companionable silence, watching the stars and dwelling on their thoughts, their hopes, their dreams, or their lack thereof. In the weeks since the terrible events in Atlanta, Remy had dwelled incessantly on Ethan, on Theo, on Nicola, and on Avi. Especially on Avi. Every time her thoughts lit on the woman, she was bothered by the suspicion that there was something more to the story. Avi had hidden something important from them.
Her mannerisms, the way she'd avoided directly answering questions, her flowery speeches, her flat-out seeming helplessness when facing down the infected, all made that glaringly obvious. But what that something was, Remy had no way to find out. The other woman was dead and, therefore, impervious to Remy's questions and accusations, no matter how loudly she shouted them in her head. She hadn't been affected by Avi's death beyond the initial sudden shock of it. After all, she'd only known the woman for a few days at that point. But the one who'd fallen only minutes after her? A sob threatened to well up in her throat as Ethan's face appeared in her mind's eye, but she quickly tamped it down. She couldn't stop the upset that stirred in her gut, though. Ethan Bennett had fallen, had met a terrible death at the hands of the infected while trying to save the rest of them. While trying to save her. And she had fought, had tried to get him before it was too late. But Brandt hadn't allowed it. He'd held her down, pinned her to a rooftop, while on the ground below, Ethan had died. Remy wasn't sure she'd ever forgive Brandt for that. Boots scraped on the roof behind her, shuffling and bumping as their owner climbed through the second-story window to join her. She pulled her knees to her chest and set her bolo knife beside her, lovingly tracing her fingertips over its wooden hilt before wrapping her arms around her knees. The owner of the boots approached.
Hey.
A quiet voice greeted her. Brandt, of course. Her chest constricted at the sound of his voice, and she couldn't help but think on the words he'd said to her when he broke the news of Ethan's sacrifice.
He stayed behind to give the rest of us a chance.
But she hadn't wanted that chance. She just wanted Ethan.
Hey, Brandt, Remy replied.
She suppressed a sigh as her hope for peace and quiet was dashed. She could just ask him to leave her be, and he'd likely do it. But despite the lurking bitterness she felt toward him, she still wanted his company, any company. So she kept her mouth shut and pressed her lips together as the tall, muscular man settled onto the shingles beside her.
I thought it was Gray's turn to keep watch,
Brandt commented. He rested an arm against his bent knee and glanced at her.
What are you doing up here?
She shrugged and kept her eyes locked onto the darkness. She couldn't see it, but if she strained her ears, she could make out the faint sounds of the Atlantic Ocean, its dark gray waters breaking on the beaches a mere 2 blocks away. She'd seen it only once, when they first arrived in the tiny coastal South Carolinian town near Hollywood. She'd immediately disliked it. It was a far cry from the beautiful blue waters and sugar-white sands of the Gulf of Mexico near which she'd grown up. Compared to that paradise, the coastline in the distance looked like something out of Dante's Inferno.
Couldn't sleep, Remy finally admitted after the silence stretched for too long. Figured I'd let Gray get some rest since I'm awake anyway.
Brandt gave her a sad smile that she just barely saw in the moonlight.
Thinking too much?
He asked gently, understandingly. Remy didn't want his understanding.
You don't even know the half of it,
she muttered. Her voice revealed how disgusted she was. At whom, though, she wasn't sure.
You could try me,
Brandt offered. His own voice was tinged with a fair amount of the concern that did a fantastic job of pissing Remy off. She didn't want him to waste his time being concerned over her. There wasn't anything to be concerned about. Remy glanced at him, ready to offer a blunt refusal. Maybe an excuse for why she didn't want to talk to him. But as she opened her mouth, she caught a glimpse of the darkness in his eyes and quickly shut it again. It was a haunted, disturbed look. The look of a man who'd stared into the pits of hell for far too long. Had seen things that couldn't be unseen.
The expression unsettled her. Maybe Brandt wanted an excuse to talk about some things. Maybe his concern over her problems was a pretense for examining his own. Are you okay? She ventured. She tucked her feet beneath her and settled onto her boots to cushion her seat against the roof. She locked her eyes on his, trying to force him to look at her. He glanced at her fleetingly before his eyes darted back to their surroundings.
What do you think I'm asking you?
Brandt replied. He ran his hands through his dark hair. The gesture reminded Remy painfully of Ethan.
You're not sleeping, he continued. You're getting, what, 2 or 3 hours every couple of nights? That's not healthy.
You're not my father, Remy muttered. Not even Eth. The name caught in her throat, and she drew a deep breath. Her eyes welled with tears, despite her best efforts to prevent their appearance.
Not even he could get away with ordering me around like that.
Brandt didn't reply right away, though he did finally look at her, studying her closely in the moonlight. She looked back at him through tears threatening to spill. Memories flooded her brain, hammered at her skull, trying to force the tears from her eyes against her will. Brandt gave her a sad smile and squeezed her shoulder.
Yeah, I missed him too, he admitted. I miss all of them.
That was all it took for the tears to stream down her face. Remy bit her bottom lip, but the pain from her teeth did nothing to quell the sobs that clawed up from the empty hole Ethan's death had left inside her. The next thing she knew, Remy was in Brandt's arms with her face pressed against his chest as painful, gut-wrenching sobs she'd fought for a month to restrain broke free. She grieved for all her lost friends, for Nicola and Avi and Theo, and especially Ethan. But she also cried for the four of them who were left, the ones stuck coping with the losses they'd sustained in such rapid succession, and the difficulties they now faced in surviving without the man they'd looked to as their figurehead for the past year.
Why did he have to do that? She managed. Why did he have to play the motherfucking martyr? Couldn't he see that we need him? That I need him?
Of course, Remy, he said, rubbing her back in slow, soothing circles.
Of course he could see that. Of course he knew we needed him. That's why he did what he did. He cared enough. He loved all of us enough to give up his own life so we'd have a chance to keep ours.
Remy looked at him again. The dark, haunted expression was back in his eyes.
If he hadn't done that, the infected would have circled the building and swarmed us when we came out of the front doors. And then we all would have died. Ethan would never have found something like that acceptable.
Remy let out a shaky breath and lay against Brandt, her eyes closed, listening to his heartbeat and his steady breathing. It was the closest she'd ever felt to him, like being comforted by an older brother she'd never had. The thought made the bitterness inside her subside, made a fleeting smile brush against her lips. Brandt ran his fingers over her hair and kissed the center of her forehead. Then he dug a tissue from his pocket and pressed it into her hand.
Thanks,
Remy murmured, wiping at her eyes. She squeezed them shut and fought to gain control of herself. It felt like everything inside her was displaced, like her stomach was squished into the middle of her back and her heart was stuffed down by her liver.
God, what is wrong with me? She asked. I'm not acting like me at all.
She gave Brandt a tight smile that barely masked the tears still threatening.
Fuck. I'm okay. I promise.
Brandt rubbed her back again and looked across the yard with a vacant expression.
You lost someone you love, he said. I can't imagine how hard that is. I haven't dealt with that in a long time.
He glanced at the window behind them.
I hope I never do either.
She pulled away from him and glanced at the window.
Speaking of which, how's Cade today? Any improvement?
He brightened,
I think her fever finally broke, he said with enthusiasm. She's noticeably cooler than she was yesterday.
Remy gave him a happy smile as relief coursed through her. They'd all been crazy with worry over Cade. Brandt had almost gone insane with the stress he'd experienced over her briefly worsened condition. The infection, thankfully not one of the Michaluk variety, brought on by the gunshot wound to Cade's side, had raged through her body for 3 weeks, and they'd fought a desperate war against it. They'd pumped her full of what few antibiotics they had, given her as many fluids as they could work down her throat, constantly bathed her with cool cloths as her fever skyrocketed and her body sweated and shivered. They hadn't been sure they were treating the infection properly, but they'd taken the baseline of information that both Brandt and Gray knew and run with it. They'd clearly done something right. Cade's fever breaking was a very good sign.
Got scary there for a bit, didn't it?
Brandt asked. His voice was thick with an emotion Remy recognized immediately.
You're in love with her, aren't you?
She murmured. With the way he constantly glanced at the window, it was clear where he wanted to be. And it was not on the roof with her. Not that she blamed him. Brandt didn't look surprised by her question. He shifted his eyes to hers and nodded.
Yeah, of course, he said, as if it were obvious.
She traced a circle over the knee of her jeans, picking threads out of a hole in the fabric. She dabbed the tissue at her eyes again.
Would you marry her? If you could?
He looked at the shingles, considering her question.
I think if it were an option, I would, he admitted. But I don't think it is. Hell knows the world's so bad off, the chances of finding a priest in this cesspool are slim to none. Oh, you're a traditionalist, she mused. She patted him on the arm and smiled.
You know what I think? In this world, you don't need a priest to be married in the eyes of God, so long as you're both faithful.
I think in circumstances like these, God would understand if you said you were married.
He looked up at the night sky.
I don't know. Maybe I want something more than just us saying, oh hey, we're married.
He made a few overly dramatic hand gestures and Remy laughed.
I can't explain it. Besides, I don't even have a ring for her.
I don't think Cade cares about all that, she admonished him. She never struck me as being into the whole flowers and romance and rings and churches thing. She clapped her hands.
But I'll tell you what, I'll talk to Gray. He's still— No, don't do that,
Brandt protested. She swatted his arm to stop him.
Shush, man, she ordered. I'll talk to Gray. He's still got his family's Bible. He might not be ordained, but I don't think that matters. Next time you and Gray go on supply, you can hunt down some rings. I bet Gray would marry you guys sometime after you got back. When you're ready for that, of course.
Brandt hesitated. The dark look in his eyes had been replaced by a hopeful expression.
You think it's a good idea?
He asked.
I mean, is it something Cade would even be interested in?
Don't worry about it so much, Remy said. Take your time with it, okay? Talk to her about it when she wakes up. See what she thinks. Brandt nodded, raking his hands through his hair and staring into the darkness. As he reclined back to gaze at the stars above their heads, Remy saw a little of the something Cade likely saw in the man. The softness in his eyes, the way his hair fell over his forehead, even the dreamy quality about the way he looked at the sky. This was a man who, despite his military background and what she called his general badassery, was a dreamer through and through, and obviously a romantic. If Cade were smart, she thought, she'd dig her claws into this man and hang on to him for dear life, because she'd never find another one like him. Remy wasn't certain that men like Brandt even existed anymore. Remy glanced at the window again and cleared her throat to get his attention.
He shifted his eyes to her and raised an eyebrow. I think I'm actually getting tired, she said. Do you mind? She motioned vaguely to the rooftop around them.
Yeah, sure. Of course, Brandt said. You don't even have to ask. Go get some rest, Rem.
Remy smiled at the nickname and stood, her boots scraping on the shingles as she gained her feet.
Thanks. I'll come get you as soon as I wake up.
She climbed a few steps up the roof slope before pausing behind him and dropping a kiss on top of his head. It was impulsive, but it felt like the right thing to do. Then, without another word, she crawled up to the window and slipped through it into the darkness beyond. Chapter 2.
I need to get out of here.
Ethan's breath fogged the frigid pane of glass in front of him. He stared from the 18th floor over the darkened city of Atlanta. It looked strangely alien. So large and yet so quiet. The infected weren't visible from his vantage point as the sun dropped below the horizon and threw the city into terrifying darkness. If it weren't for the lack of streetlights and traffic lights, he'd have thought the city looked almost normal. Ethan had been at the Westin in downtown Atlanta for roughly a month. He couldn't be sure exactly how long, because he had no idea what date he'd met his fate in the city. He worked in approximates now. Approximately how long he'd been there. Approximately how long the search for Brandt had been going on. Approximately how long he had left to live. They were approximates he hated. But right now, the approximate he wanted to narrow down was approximately how much longer he'd have to wait until he was allowed to go anywhere.
You're more than welcome to go anywhere in the hotel you want to, Alicia Day said. Nothing is stopping you.
Ethan slammed his fist against the window.
I mean out there, he said. Not the fucking hotel.
He forced his hand away from the glass and clenched his fists at his sides, struggling to control himself.
I should be helping search for Brandt.
The scuff of boots on carpet met his ears, and pale, slender arms looped around his waist. Alicia's reflection hovered, ghost-like, in the glass over his right shoulder. She studied his face as she rubbed her hands slowly over his sides. Despite the anger still rattling through his veins, no matter how much he fought it, Ethan was pulled helplessly toward relaxation. Alicia just had that effect on him, similar to the effect Remy always had. Thank God for that, because he angered so much more easily now.
You still don't remember where you and Brandt planned to take the others after Atlanta?
Alicia asked. Her hands traced over his ribs, almost distracting him from his anger. Almost. He swallowed and shook his head slowly. The Michaluk virus had done a number on his brain, eradicating random portions of his memory, much to his frustration. Alicia had gotten to him quickly enough to prevent the virus's worst effects, but she hadn't been able to do anything about the memory loss, a symptom she'd admitted to having never seen before. It drove him insane. There were things he was supposed to know, but every time he tried to drag those things from the depths of his mind, they eluded him. Ethan must have tensed again, because Alicia's arms tightened around him, and her translucent reflection shook its head.
Calm down. Breathe. Don't force it. It'll come to you eventually. Pushing it will only make it harder for you to remember. I need to be out there, he said again.
His anger slid away from him. He thumped the glass with his fist, though not as violently as before.
I'm tired of this place. I'm tired of feeling like I'm trapped. I need to find my friends. I need to help them. I know. But Ethan, you can't leave yet, she said. There's the problem with adjusting your meds, and your wounds aren't fully healed. You still move too slowly, and that's a fast way to die out there.
I'm not willing to risk you. Not just yet.
He closed his eyes and sagged against her, digging his blunt fingernails into his palms. A surge of guilt ran through him. All she wanted was to keep him safe, to keep him from getting killed.
Fuck. I'm sorry, he muttered. I didn't think of it that way. You're right. Of course.
You're not the only person who's wanted to jump the gun and run while still dealing with the after effects of getting infected, Alicia admitted. She gave him another squeeze and took a half step back. She still stood so close that he felt the warmth of her body near his.
Speaking of which, it's about time we changed your bandages. I want to see how your wounds are healing.
Ethan sighed, giving in to the inevitable. He hated having his bandages changed. The tape went out of its way to hurt as much as possible when peeling away from his skin. Despite his reluctance, however, he went to the disheveled, unmade king-sized bed, sinking down onto the end of it and leaning forward obediently. He eased his white tank off, wincing as the medical tape pulled harshly at his torn skin. Then he rested his arms against his thighs, exposing his back for Alicia's perusal. The redhead moved the camping lantern from the dresser to the table by the bed and retrieved the first aid supplies before she climbed onto the bed beside him. She kicked her boots off and sat on her knees behind him, smoothing her hands gently over his back. He suppressed a shiver, barely, as her fingers ghosted along his skin. She slipped a fingernail beneath the edge of the tape and peeled it up. An ache immediately coursed through Ethan's veins, pulsing through his wounds. He sucked in a breath and dug his nails into the knees of his pants, closing his eyes and relaxing as much as the pain allowed.
Talk to me, Alicia requested.
She pulled away the first strip of tape, folded it on itself, and set it on the bed.
What am I supposed to talk about? I don't know. Anything.
She stripped the next piece of tape off, and he flinched as it pulled the wound nearest it.
Tell me about your friends. Which ones are you closest to?
Ethan bit his lip as the tape ripped away from his skin. Alicia set it and a square of gauze on the bed. He frowned as he noticed specks of blood on it.
I don't know anymore, he admitted. It used to be Cade, but I'm not sure how close we are anymore. Over the months before Avi showed up, we'd started to drift apart. I think because I was spending more time with Remy.
And Remy was your girlfriend? Alicia asked. She started on the next square of gauze. Ethan tried not to cringe at the question. Instead, he studied the carpet intently and gripped his knees tighter.
Honestly, I've no idea what we were, he said. Things got heated with us only in the last 3 months. Even then, it started by accident. We didn't plan any of this shit.
What did you plan? She leaned close to study the bandage hooked over his left shoulder, following the tape to its end against his chest and tugging at it. It peeled away easily. He felt her breath against his neck and closed his eyes, shrugging.
I don't know. Definitely not a relationship, Ethan said. We were attracted to each other. She's way outside my age range, so I don't know why I became so attached to her. Just one thing led to another and it spiraled out of control. The rest of the group had no idea and she wanted to keep it that way.
Think it was proximity? Alicia suggested.
Maybe. I don't know.
Did you love her? She asked. She tugged the last of the gauze from his back. A scab peeled away from the wound, and he gritted his teeth and hissed, tensing. She hummed softly and rubbed the back of his neck in apology.
I don't know,
he said after the initial sting of pain subsided.
I didn't get in too deep. Or at least, I tried not to. I don't know how she felt. I'm not asking how she felt, Alicia murmured. Her fingers brushed his blonde hair aside, and her lips pressed against the nape of his neck. He closed his eyes and suppressed another shiver. He wasn't used to Alicia's forwardness. He supposed the conditions in which they lived caused many, including Alicia and even, to some extent, himself, to do things they might not have done if uninfected. Everything moved almost too quickly for him to handle. I'm asking how you felt, she persisted. She moved on to his arms to unwrap the gauze looped around them. A trickle of something wet and warm dripped down between his shoulder blades.
I don't know how I felt, he said.
He was reluctant to admit anything so personal to Alicia. They'd shared a bed a few times over the past couple of weeks. They shared common ground and a fear of the future. And yet, he still couldn't share his feelings about Remy with her. He usually avoided discussions about his and Remy's relationship, not to mention his marriage to Anna. He was sure she knew about them anyway. She seemed to know more about him than he knew about him.
I guess I loved her,
Ethan confessed after a silence filled only by the sound of tearing tape. He consciously downplayed his feelings, not willing to give Alicia more than necessary.
Enough to matter anyway, considering we did what we could to not fall in love.
Do you still feel that way? Alicia asked. She turned his right arm over and peeled at the tape on the underside of his forearm. Her eyes were intent on the gauze, her hair falling into her face. He wanted to brush it out of her eyes, but he couldn't with the grip she still had on his arm.
Do you still feel like you're not supposed to be with anyone? More so than ever,
Ethan said. The fervency in his voice surprised even him.
I've got Michaluk. I'm living on borrowed time. There's no way I'd subject someone I love to this.
Same here,
Alicia agreed. She added the piece of gauze to the growing pile on the table.
It's not worth falling in love when it won't be long before we all die.
Ethan took her hand, lacing his fingers with hers and squeezing it. She sighed and continued.
I shouldn't be so morbid, she said.
She cracked open the first aid kit, taking out the tapes and gauzes and wound cleansers she'd use. She followed with a small pair of scissors and tweezers. Ethan tensed at the sight. This was going to hurt.
I should think positively. I should tell myself we're going to find Evans and be able to convince him to help us.
Alicia started cleaning the wound on his right forearm. Ethan dug his nails into his knees again.
Do you think he'll cooperate?
He asked.
I don't know, she admitted.
She dabbed a stray streak of blood from his skin.
That's something you can answer a hell of a lot better than I can.
She tore strips of medical tape from the roll and stuck one end of each to the edge of the kit's box in a neat row.
Do you think he'll help us?
Ethan hesitated, thinking over the little he knew about the man. Brandt had never been open about his past. He clung to it, kept it close where no one could use it against him. He had always harbored the suspicion that Brandt was hiding something from the rest of them, and Alicia had confirmed that a month prior. As for how Brandt would react to what Alicia needed him for,
I'm not sure, he said. I think so. I hope so. But I'm not sure I know much about him, considering all you've told me this month that I didn't know before. I honestly don't know if the Brandt you knew will do it.
Alicia began to wrap fresh gauze around Ethan's arm.
I hope he will. Not for my sake or your sake, but for the sake of the children here. We fucked up this world. We messed around with things we had no business messing with. The children shouldn't have to suffer because of our mistakes.
By the time Remy took his place on watch shortly before sunrise, Brandt was exhausted. His head felt like it was packed with cotton, and his eyes were dry and scratchy. To say he was ready to crawl into bed, or, well, chair, and not move until after lunch was an understatement. It was with that thought in mind that he climbed through the second-story window. He rubbed his eyes and shuffled to the master bedroom, where he'd stayed since their arrival at the safe house. The room brightened with the first hints of sunrise, but Brandt still couldn't see well as he collapsed into the armchair by the bed. He slouched weakly for a long moment before leaning down to take his boots off. He managed to unlace his left boot, and he'd begun the process of untying the right one, when a shift of movement from the king-sized bed caught his attention. Brandt tensed and straightened, his eyes locking onto the dark form in the bed. It was Cade, he was well aware of that. After all, he'd spent the past 3 weeks sleeping in the very chair in which he now sat, constantly on alert for changes in her condition, for better or worse. It was with a fair amount of anxiety that he abandoned his boots and knelt on the floor beside the bed. He brushed his fingertips over Cade's blessedly cool forehead. The woman stared at him in the hazy gloom filtering through the curtains. The sight of her eyes, open and clear with recognition and relative alertness, made him draw in a slow breath of relief.
"Hey. Welcome back,"
he said in a hushed tone.
"Hi," Cade whispered back. Her voice was faint and cracked, but she sounded as coherent as her eyes suggested.
He moved his fingers to her cheeks, feeling her damp skin for fever.
"You've been out for a while," he said. "How do you feel?"
"Like shit," she mumbled.
She attempted to clear her throat and failed miserably.
"Where are we?"
"Little town near the Atlantic coast,"
he answered. He stood and grabbed a shopping bag from the nightstand, digging through it for an unopened water bottle.
"We're somewhere outside Charleston. It's the same little town Ethan and I planned to bring all of you to if we didn't get the help we needed in Atlanta. He had the maps when, well, when he stayed behind. So I had to work off my memory on which blocks we planned to check for a safe house. Did the best I could with the little I remembered."
As Brandt turned back to her with a freshly opened bottle of water, he caught a glimpse of apprehension in Cade's eyes. He eased onto the edge of the bed and helped her sit up, waiting until he'd helped her drink from the bottle before he prompted,
"What's on your mind?"
Cade hesitated and ran her fingers lightly over the outside of the bottle.
"He's dead, isn't he?"
Brandt pressed his lips together and nodded.
"Yeah. Yeah, he is,"
he confirmed.
"I'm so sorry, babe."
She looked away from him and closed her eyes.
"I just had this weird feeling, like maybe it was part of a bad dream. I wanted to be sure."
When her eyes opened and met his again, they were surprisingly calm. The thought of her suppressing her grief over Ethan like she'd done for her niece disturbed him. He'd always believed the dead should be mourned, and Cade was refusing to do so. That could lead to nothing but trouble. She cleared her throat and took another slow sip of water.
"How bad is it?"
Brandt removed his boots before he replied. He spent the time evaluating Cade's question, debating different answers, trying to settle on the best way to report the group's situation. There was no good way to do it, he acknowledged. All the news he had to offer was bad. But in the end, all he could do was give it. Attempting to sanitize his report would earn him an epic ass-kicking from her at the soonest available opportunity once she figured out he'd done so.
"We thought you weren't going to make it,"
he started. He kept his voice almost monotonous in an effort to keep his emotions in check.
"You were so fucking sick, and we weren't sure if we were even dealing with it correctly. We muddled our way through it, and Gray did everything he remembered Theo telling him about wound care, and I tried to remember everything I learned in basic training. But you kept getting sicker and sicker. Gray and I went out on a couple of supply runs, but we stopped when I got nervous about your condition. I didn't want to not be here if you weren't going to pull through.
He didn't look at her as he spoke, feeling vulnerable at the admission. When he did look at her again, though, he was surprised to see a smile on her face. She sipped again from her water bottle and carefully twisted the cap back on.
Well, as you can see, I did pull through. You're stuck with me, Brandt. Get used to it.
Brandt chuckled and examined Cade again. She looked weak and skinny, pale and exhausted, despite the long rest she'd had over the past 3 weeks. Regardless, he gave her a smile and said, though he didn't believe a word of it,
Well, I can see you'll pop right back to your old self pretty quick.
He glanced at the open bedroom door, debating going to find Gray, in case the other man needed to do anything health-related to her. Then he shook his head and slid closer to Cade. He didn't think Gray's presence was necessary right now.
Do you need anything?
He offered.
I can get whatever you want.
Yeah, I need to know how everybody is,
Cade said. She twisted her fingers into the sheets draped over her.
How's Remy?
Is she okay?
What about Gray? How are they handling all this shit?
A flash of Remy's tearful near collapse on the roof flitted through his mind.
Honestly, they're not,
he admitted. He chose not to mention too many specifics. It felt too personal, something to keep between him and Remy. But he couldn't deny she wasn't doing well. He slowly shook his head, emotion that earned him a curious look.
Remy, she pretty much lives on the roof. She says she's keeping watch, but I think it's more that she doesn't want to be around the rest of us. And then there's Gray. He is... Well, he's Gray. Keeps to himself, only leaves his room for watch to check on you or to go out for supplies. We don't see him very much otherwise.
Cade glanced at the sheets as if she could see the wound in her side through the layers of fabric.
Gray's been doing this?
She asked in surprise.
Well, I helped,
he said lamely. She laughed, though she grimaced halfway through. He touched her shoulder. Concerned.
Hey, are you okay?
Cade sucked in a slow, steadying breath.
Yeah, I'm fine. Just sore is all. Wasn't really expecting that to hurt.
Brandt rested his hand loosely on top of hers, tracing his thumb over the soft skin covering her knuckles as he let out a wide yawn. He rubbed his eyes, squinting myopically at her. And she grinned at him.
I hate to ask, but I've been sleeping in a chair for about 3 weeks and...
A chair?
Cade repeated.
Your poor back.
Exactly.
He hesitated and glanced at the open door again, more out of an abundance of nervousness than anything else, and wondered if he should get up to close it.
Do you mind if I sleep up here tonight? I don't want to accidentally smack you in the side or whatever. But I really can't take sleeping in that chair again.
Cade's grin widened and she shuffled sideways to make room for him.
You know you didn't have to ask,
she pointed out after she'd settled against the pillows once more.
I know, but with my luck you'd wake up in the middle of the night and freak out and punch me,
Brandt said with a chuckle. He eased back onto the bed with a low groan, feeling his tired muscles relaxing painfully.
With your luck, I still might.
Alicia stepped into the dim hallway and let the door fall closed behind her with a soft click, her flashlight beam playing over the empty hallway as she smoothed her free hand over her wrinkled clothes. She tried to finger comb her tangled hair before giving up and moving to the stairwell door. Dominic Jackson would be waiting for her just inside the stairwell. She always met him there after her lengthy interrogation sessions with Ethan Bennett. And once again, Dominic didn't disappoint. As Alicia pushed the door open and stepped onto the landing, the tall, dark-skinned man stood from his spot on the stairs leading to the 17th floor, switching on his own flashlight and shining it in her direction, careful not to shine it directly in her face. She eased the door shut behind her and turned her own flashlight off, and he gave her a questioning look.
So how'd it go?
Like normal, she reported, a wry smile crossing her face. He still doesn't remember where the group was headed. She shoved both hands into her pockets. I just don't get it. Out of all the infected people we've dealt with, why is he the only one we've seen with memory loss?
Do you think he's lying? Dominic suggested. Or faking it?
They began to descend the stairs together, walking in stride with each other out of unconscious habit. I don't think so, she admitted. He genuinely doesn't remember. You can tell by how frustrated he gets. He knows they made plans, but he doesn't remember what those plans were. She walked with Dominic down another couple of flights before she added, I learned more about this Cade woman he referenced last week. Dominic looked intrigued.
And what did you find out?
She's of Israeli descent, former IDF, Alicia said. She contemplated the information she'd learned. She's a sniper.
A sniper? Dominic repeated. She could be useful. Not many of those around anymore. Is she any good?
One of the best, as far as I understand, she said. Ethan's description of her skills was impressive, even taking bias into consideration. She ran a hand through her knotted hair and added, There's some question as to whether she's still alive, though. Remember how, last month, Daniels followed the other four as far as Centennial Olympic Park and said that one of them was carried most of the way? He nodded.
Yeah, I remember. What happened to her?
Alicia looked at him, her expression grim in the bluish light from the flashlight. Ethan says she was shot.
Shot? But Kyle's orders were only to take down Avi, he said.
No. Kyle's orders were to take down Avi and leave Evans unharmed. I didn't care what he did about the others, she corrected. I didn't understand their potential value at the time. Regardless, Ethan says she won't join us. Not willingly.
What makes him say that?
Dominic asked. A hint of curiosity tinged his words. He says Cade is absolutely loyal and devoted to the other members of the group, and that as long as they need her, she won't leave them, Alicia explained. She stopped on the 8th floor landing and caught Dominic's arm, forcing him to a halt, her expression serious. Also, Ethan says she and Evans are lovers.
Lovers?
Dominic's curiosity gave way to incredulousness.
How is that even? I mean, he's infected.
I know, Alicia said. It's all there in black and white in Dr. Rivers' files. But they're definitely lovers. Ethan's absolutely certain of it.
And she's not infected. At all?
Alicia shook her head. She's not, she confirmed. I think if she'd shown symptoms, it would have been significant enough for him to mention. Dominic dislodged his arm and started down the next flight of stairs. Alicia moved to join him.
Maybe you should just ask him,
he suggested.
And risk ruining the illusion?
Alicia smirked. Please. He's not even aware he's being interrogated. I want to keep it that way. It makes him trust me. And that makes him more likely to tell me things I might not get out of him in a straight-up grilling. Dominic opened the door to the 6th floor, motioning for her to step into the hallway beyond with a grand sweep of his arm.
I just never knew so much deviousness could hide behind such a pretty face.
She laughed. The pretty ones are usually the most devious, she pointed out. As she stepped into the hallway that led toward the 6th floor lobby and the overlook beyond it, a young woman approached them at a run. She clutched a large, crumpled paper, and her short, blonde hair flopped into her face.
Alicia, we've got it, she said breathlessly.
She jammed the paper into Alicia's hands, crushing it in her palms. Alicia raised an eyebrow and looked at the paper the woman had given her.
What is this, Kimberly?
she asked. She tried in vain to smooth the paper out as Dominic looked over her shoulder. It was a map of Georgia, she realized, scribbled over with multiple handwritings that made it difficult to read. At the edge of the map was a sliver of South Carolina, with a small town circled and several blocks of it shaded in.
You remember when you guys brought Mr. Bennett in and he had that bag with all the blood on it with him?
Kimberly said.
We spent the past 3 weeks sterilizing the bag to hell and back just so we could find out what he was carrying at the time of the attack.
Alicia didn't need to ask why they'd had to sterilize the bag. Dr. Rivers and his assistant, Kimberly, the very woman who stood before her, were uninfected. They were also the most important people in the building, because they were tasked with developing a cure for the virus. As such, they couldn't risk getting infected.
We found all kinds of stuff in his bag, but this is a goldmine of information, Kimberly explained. It's a map of Georgia and parts of South Carolina.
Yeah, I gathered that.
With Mr. Bennett's group's roots marked out on it, Kimberly continued, including...
She tapped her finger dramatically on the map Alicia still grasped in her hands.
Their alternate plan for what to do if they couldn't get help in Atlanta. Which, if I recall, is something you guys were interested in knowing.
Alicia slowly raised her head to look at Kimberly before she shifted her eyes to Dominic. He looked back at her, his dark eyes wide with surprise.
So this means... It means we know where Evans is, Dominic said,
his voice just as stunned as hers. Chapter 3. The scent of scrambled eggs was the most appealing thing Gray had smelled in 3 days, he reflected as he came down the stairs near lunchtime. His stomach rumbled in agreement, even as his brain considered whether it was a good thing that the powdered eggs were finally being used. Regardless, they still smelled okay, so he headed for the kitchen. Gray was surprised to find Brandt at the portable camp stove on the kitchen counter. The older man swore under his breath and jabbed a fork at the watery mound of yellow, semi-fluff in the pan. He skirted past Brandt to retrieve a bottle of water from the kitchen table.
Actually making some hot food, huh?
He observed. He motioned to the camp stove with his water bottle and leaned against the counter to watch. He figured Brandt cooking would provide plenty of entertainment. The last time the Marine had tried to cook, the camp stove had gotten the better of him and ended up halfway across the kitchen, and he and Remy had ended up mopping up the soup that had been spilled all over the floor in the process.
Dare I ask the occasion?
What?
A guy has to have an occasion to cook fucking breakfast?
Brandt grumbled. He poked at the eggs again and grimaced.
Maybe I just wanted to be nice and cook some real food. No way am I going to believe that,
Gray said.
If you were cooking real food, you'd be using real eggs. Wish we had some of those. At least they'd scramble like they're supposed to,
Brandt muttered. Gray grinned and put his bottle on the counter, wiggling his fingers at Brandt.
Come on, give me the fork. I'll finish that before you burn something, like maybe the house all around our heads.
Brandt made an obnoxious face at him and passed the fork over before retreating. Gray turned to the eggs on the stove, picked up the pan, and drained some liquid off.
For starters, you put way too much water in them. You trying to make egg soup? Okay, Iron Chef,
Brandt said. He grabbed his own water bottle.
I don't need a cooking lesson. I need some fucking eggs on a plate so I can take them upstairs to Cade.
Why would Cade need eggs?
He asked. She's practically...
He trailed off, stiffened, and looked at Brandt in surprise.
Wait. Cade's awake? Woke up about 4 this morning,
Brandt said, leaning against the dining table and taking a swig of water.
No fever, thank God. Her side is sore, but otherwise she's doing okay. She complained about being hungry when I woke up, so I said I'd see what I could do. And apparently it's not much,
he joked.
He grabbed a plate and started spooning cooked egg onto it.
You don't have to tell her I finished these. It can be our little secret, okay? Hey, she already knows I can't cook for shit,
Brandt pointed out. He took the plate and searched for a clean fork.
She's probably upstairs saying the Lord's Prayer in hope it'll prevent her from dying after she eats this.
Gray laughed and grabbed two more plates.
Remy eat yet?
He asked, offering one of the plates to Brandt. The man waved it off.
I'm not hungry, and I haven't seen Remy since this morning.
Brandt glanced at the ceiling.
I think she's still on the roof.
Gray scraped the eggs from one of the plates into a bowl instead and scooped up a fresh bottle of water.
I'll take her some food then. Let me know when Cade's done eating, okay? I want to take a look at her side.
Brandt caught him by the shoulder as he passed.
Remy isn't doing too great,
he warned.
She broke down pretty bad last night. I think she's still hurting over Ethan's death.
Gray frowned and followed Brandt's gaze to the ceiling, even as a pang of jealousy raced through him. He pushed the feeling aside.
Aren't we all?
He replied.
Too much shit happened too fast. I don't think my brain has caught up with it all yet.
He shifted his eyes to the floor and shrugged.
I still get this weird feeling that Theo's going to come around the corner any minute and start bitching at all of us about how shitty we're eating.
He sighed and shook his head.
I'll see what I can do for her, okay? I'm not the world's greatest at this kind of thing. Knowing me, I'm going to say the wrong thing, and she's going to punch me. You'll be fine,
Brandt assured him. He clapped Gray's shoulder one more time, nearly jarring the bowl of eggs out of his hands, then picked up Cade's plate and headed for the stairs.
Speaking of eating right, he said as Gray followed, we're going to head out on a supply run within the next day or so. Those eggs and a few boxes of cereal are all we've got left. When should we go? I don't know. Maybe late tomorrow morning? We should check out the downtown area,
Brandt suggested.
We didn't go that way last time. Maybe we'll get lucky and find something useful there. Now that Cade's awake, I feel more comfortable leaving her with Remy,
he admitted.
Remy's so, I don't know, flighty lately. It's like she's not all there. It makes me nervous.
Grace started to reply, but hesitated.
You don't think she's suicidal or anything, do you? Honestly, I'm not sure, Brandt said. I just know I don't want her alone on that roof right now.
Gray split off from him at the top of the stairs, cut through a bedroom, and slipped out onto the roof. The process was awkward with a bowl and bottle of water in his hands, but he managed nonetheless. Once he found his footing, he started toward the corner of the roof where he could see Remy's thin form. She stared out across the overcast scenery, her knees drawn to her chest. He approached cautiously.
Hey,
he greeted her. He settled onto the roof a few feet from Remy and stretched out his legs, setting the water down beside her and offering her the bowl.
Brought you some eggs. Are they that powdered shit?
She asked. She kept her dark eyes locked onto the street below, as if he weren't there. He frowned and nodded, setting the bowl beside her water.
Of course, he said. There isn't much else. Brandt's talking about going out on supply tomorrow. That's nice.
Gray stared at her, confused and a little hurt at her uncaring attitude. But instead of addressing it, he remained silent and cast his gaze onto the street alongside hers. Everything was still. No threats in their immediate vicinity. He glanced once more at Remy's silent figure. She'd picked up the bowl of eggs and started to eat, slowly and mechanically, the fork tapping softly against the glass bowl as her hands shook noticeably from too much caffeine.
I'm sorry, Remy, he said. What are you apologizing for? The eggs aren't that bad,
she replied. Her words were muffled by the bowl as she leaned closer to it in an effort to keep the eggs on her trembling fork.
No, not for the eggs,
he said in exasperation.
For last month. For being a shit. You know, out on the road. His cheeks heated with embarrassment as he said the words. When I found out about you and Ethan. Remy waved her fork at him. Old news. Ancient history. I'm not even worried about it anymore, she said. She swallowed the egg in her mouth and scooped up another forkful. Doesn't matter anymore anyway. Even past the food in her mouth, he could hear the bitterness in her voice. He shifted awkwardly on the roof, leaned back against his hands, and tried to decide what to say next. I finally went through Theo's stuff, Gray said. He stared at the brick house across the street. It sat in the center of a sea of waist-high grass. Well, what's left of it anyway? He didn't have much personal stuff in his bag. At least you have some of his things, Remy said. Ethan had all his stuff on him when he went, I don't even have anything. Her voice cracked, and she blinked rapidly and looked away. She set the nearly empty bowl on the shingles beside her. Gray loosely wrapped his hand around her wrist and squeezed, leaving it there for a moment before forcing himself to let go. Silence hovered between them. He simply sat and watched her out of the corner of his eye, trying to dredge up a way to continue the conversation. Theo had stuff in his bag with names on it, he said. Yours was on something. Really? What kind of stuff was it? Remy asked. She discreetly wiped her eyes with her jacket's cuff. Things he wanted us to have if we outlived him, Gray said. Sort of like a will, I guess. He stood and headed for the window again. Wait right here. I'll get yours. Gray ducked back through the window and went to his room, snagging Theo's bag off the floor by his bed. He dug all the way to the bottom of the bag and pulled out a small box with the word Remy written on three sides in his brother's familiar, messy handwriting. His chest constricted at the sight, but he shook the sensation off and tucked the box under his arm. He hurried back to the roof, hoping Remy hadn't had the brilliant idea to leave and make him hunt for her. Thankfully, she was right where he'd left her. When he rejoined her, he set the box beside her hand and settled onto the shingles once more. Remy picked the box up, intrigued, and traced her fingertips over Theo's handwriting before opening the box. Once she pulled the top free, a smile spread across her face. She lifted a small gun from the box and studied it in the overcast afternoon light. What's this? She asked, resting the gun flat in her hand. It's a Ruger LCP, Gray said. I asked Theo to help me find one back in October because I wanted to give you one for your birthday. We never did find one, but I guess he came across this one and held on to it. Maybe for this year instead. It's good for a backup piece that you can hide on you. It holds 6 bullets, plus 1 chambered. It's awesome, she said. She set the gun back into the box and wrapped her arms around him. Gray returned the hug, closing his eyes as he held her close. She dropped a kiss onto his cheek and pulled away to examine the gun again. It's a cute little gun. I love it. She retrieved one of the small bullets from the box and squinted at it. A genuine smile spread across her face, something he hadn't seen in what felt like ages. Just don't use it unless you absolutely have to, he warned. There are only 7 bullets in the box, and I don't know if Cade has anything left that'll fit it. And be careful with it. The manual says it has a long pull trigger, so there's no safety. I don't want to have to deal with another gunshot wound, okay? Cade's was hell as it was, and it's only by a miracle I remembered half of what Theo ever taught me. The only safety that matters is the one between your ears, Remy said sagely. You've been talking to Cade about guns too much, Gray observed with a soft laugh. I've heard her say that a million times. It's true, though. If you're too stupid to handle a gun safely, then all the safeties in the world won't keep you from getting your stupid ass shot, Remy pointed out. She stood and brushed her jeans off, stretched, and picked up the box with the bullets in it. She tucked it into her jacket pocket and gathered the bowl and water from the roof.
Let's get inside. I'm tired and I want your company. Inside.
Don't we need somebody to keep watch?
He asked, though he was intrigued at the suggestion underlying Remy's words. He stood to join her as she made her way to the window.
Fuck the watch. I haven't seen anybody in 2 weeks, maybe more than that. And that includes the infected. I think we'll be okay for a few hours. Besides, I think you need my company as much as I need yours, she said confidently.
She ducked into the window, narrowly avoiding striking her head on the frame in the process, and looked at him with a raised eyebrow.
You coming?
Gray glanced at the street behind him, wrinkling his forehead in a frown as he looked to Remy once more. She winked and offered her hand to him. It was no contest, really. He took her hand, climbing through the window and into the house again.
Hell, why not? He said. I doubt anything's going to come after us here. Right?
A fist beating on the door broke the otherwise peaceful silence of Ethan's room. Ethan tore himself from his nap and sat up straight. His gaze skittered frantically about the room, and his heart raced in his chest, adrenaline rushing into him at the sudden rude awakening. He rose from the bed and, after stopping long enough only to slip his shoes back on, headed straight for the door. He'd just reached it when it flew open, nearly hitting him in the face. A familiar red-headed figure stumbled inside and shut the door behind her. He caught Alicia's shoulder and made the woman face him. Her face looked pale in the bluish light from the flashlight she held.
What the hell is going on? He demanded. I know you didn't come here beating on my fucking door like that just to see me.
The infected, Alicia said.
She pulled a spare pistol from the waistband of her jeans and pressed it into his hand. He recognized the familiar look and feel of his Glock 17. He thought it was long gone after his fight in the alley the month before. He'd had no idea that his rescuers had recovered it.
They're attacking en masse, trying to get into the building, she continued,
bringing his attention back to her and away from his weapon.
I don't think they've succeeded yet, but we've got to put them down long before they get that far. How many are out there?
He asked, sitting on his bed and leaning over to put his shoes back on.
20, maybe 30, she said. Could be more by now. We need everyone who has experience fighting the infected.
He blew out a steadying breath and checked to make sure the pistol was loaded.
Where do you need me, then?
I want you with me,
Alicia replied. She wrenched the door open and led the way into the hall. Ethan followed obediently, almost unthinkingly.
I want to see how well you handle that weapon. That'll help me decide when it's a good idea to let you roll out on supply trips with the rest of us.
Ethan's mood lifted, despite the presence of infected on the street outside their community. The possibility, the very idea of getting out of the hotel was too amazing to contemplate. He'd begun to feel like a prisoner, and the suggestion that he actually was one had been niggling at the back of his mind. He shook the suspicion aside again and caught up to Alicia.
Let's go,
he said, enthused at the chance to blow off some steam.
I'm sick of sitting around doing nothing. I'm ready to do something useful.
So I see,
Alicia said with amusement. She led the way to the stairwell, shining her flashlight around the darkness beyond. Far below them, gunshots echoed.
I personally hope there isn't more than a quick mop-up left when we get there. I don't want to risk the infected getting inside.
Ethan nodded understandingly, and they began a quick descent of the stairs. She pushed the stairwell door open on the fourth floor. The short hallway beyond was a beehive of activity. People he'd never seen before rushed about with pistols in their hands or shotguns and rifles strapped to their backs, looking harried and overworked. Tables were shoved against the walls between conference room doors. He glanced at one table as he passed and spotted a map of Atlanta taped securely to half the table's surface. A wrinkled map of Georgia was similarly fastened beside it. On the city map, the metro area had been gridded off, and several of the squares were colored in. It seemed the suppliers for this community were systematically searching for supplies to keep the building's occupants alive. He found the level of organization impressive. As he contemplated the state map, trying to decide why it looked so familiar, a blonde woman brushed past him with a hunting rifle gripped in her hands. Alicia caught her upper arm to stop her and demanded, "Where's Dominic?"
"He went to the street level," she told Alicia. "He said something about checking the reinforcements in the parking garage to make sure the infected couldn't get past the gates."
The woman's eyes flicked past Alicia to Ethan, blatantly looking him up and down with obvious, naked interest. He nearly fidgeted under the scrutiny.
"Is there any risk of that happening?" Alicia demanded.
Her voice brought the woman's attention back to her. "Any sign of the infected getting in through there whatsoever?"
"Not that I'm aware of, but..."
"Get down there and get aware,"
Alicia ordered. She jabbed her thumb over her shoulder, indicating the lobby behind her and the escalators leading down to the parking garage.
"And let me know as soon as possible."
The woman nodded and pressed past them to head for the escalators. Ethan gave Alicia a questioning look that she ignored and followed her farther down the cluttered hallway toward the lobby.
"Where's the emergency?"
he asked as he pulled even with her and leaned close enough for her to hear him in the noisy hall.
"Outside,"
Alicia said shortly. Ethan glanced at her and imagined he could see adrenaline pumping under her skin.
"We are going in here,"
she added. She pushed open a conference room door and motioned for him to enter ahead of her.
"This is mine,"
she said, pushing the door shut. The conference room was sparsely decorated, with only a bed and table shoved into a corner. The room's long table had been moved aside, and it was lined with rows upon rows of handguns, rifles, knives, and even a few grenades. Alicia walked briskly across the room to the wall of windows, pushing the heavy curtains aside to reveal that two of the windows had already been broken out. Large wooden boards were secured over the voids. She moved the wood aside from a window and leaned out to look at the ground below.
"And that is the infected," she said,
seemingly to herself as she squinted at the ground. Ethan joined her and chose his own window, wrestling the wood board aside with some difficulty. Below, the infected were smashed against the glass and stone of the building, clawing at the sides as they tried to get in. He started counting and lost track at 24.
More steadily made their way down Andrew Young Boulevard. "What happens if they get in?"
"We seal off the parking garage and pray they go away soon,"
Alicia said, raising her voice over the wind blowing into the conference room. She slid her pistol from its holster on her thigh and leaned out enough to aim into the mass below, hanging onto the window frame.
"If they take the garage, there's no way we can get out for supplies. Once the food runs out after that, we'd be, in a word, fucked."
Ethan mimicked her position, holding the window frame tightly with his right hand and aiming his Glock with his left. He picked his target and squeezed the trigger without hesitation. The weapon kicked back in his hand, but he kept his grip on it as his mind settled into the familiar feeling he'd get when qualifying at the shooting range, back when his life actually meant something. Unfortunately, the infected man for which he'd aimed didn't go down. He gritted his teeth and adjusted his aim, firing several more shots, even as he realized the distance was too great for his pistol to reliably cover.
"Are they fucking multiplying?"
Alicia asked in frustration. Ethan didn't bother responding. Instead, he lowered the sidearm, grimacing as he watched the crowd that kept growing, kept surging against the hotel in an attempt to break its defenses. He eyed the movement below them, watching as the infected began to flood around the corner of the building.
"It's not holding," he warned Alicia. "There are too many. How many people do you have in the parking garage?"
"There isn't supposed to be anybody in the parking garage," she said. "I know Dominic is down there, but he's supposed to be hauling ass out of there and..."
"Wait.
Where are you going?"
As Alicia spoke, Ethan started for the door, his steps brisk.
"If you think for 1 second I'm leaving Dominic down there to tough it out alone, you've got another thing coming," he said.
He jerked the door open and stepped into the hallway.
Several people watched him, but he ignored them and grabbed the flashlight off a nearby table, starting across the lobby toward the escalator separating him from whatever danger lay below.
I can't believe you're doing this,
Alicia said, hurrying after him. Her expression in the light of the flashlight she held was a perfect mixture of anger, irritation, and apprehension.
You're going to get killed! So you decide to follow me and what? Witness my inevitable demise?
Ethan retorted. He rolled his eyes and focused on climbing down the escalators. Alicia lunged forward and grabbed the back of his jacket, hauling him back and nearly toppling him to the metal steps. He righted himself and turned on her.
I'm already a dead man, Alicia, he pointed out. The least you can do is let me do what I can to fucking help before I bite it. You see, this is what I have a problem with, she snapped. You're so damn defeatist. It's going to get you killed. Do you really think I care?
He asked. He pulled away from her and started down the escalator again, stepping onto the tiled hallway floor leading to the parking garage. He ran down the short hallway and burst through the glass doors at the end, emerging into the garage just as the infected managed to pull the parking garage's gate high enough to break the chain holding it closed. They swarmed the garage with single-minded intent.
Oh, you've got to be kidding me,
Ethan groaned. He lifted his Glock, resting it on top of the hand that held his flashlight, and aimed for the infected man leading the pack. It took two shots, but he brought the man down with a clean bullet to the forehead. The man fell back to the concrete, knocking two of his fellow infected down with him. He fired twice more into the mass as they rushed toward him, his shots erratic and misplaced from lack of recent practice, striking limbs and torsos. He swore at the wasted ammunition and swept his flashlight over the garage, spotting Dominic nearby. The man had situated a flashlight on the roof of the car beside him to shine toward the intruders and had a rifle to his shoulder. He fired repeatedly into the cluster of infected coming toward him, his shots mechanical and rhythmic as he plugged one bullet after another into the infected, his aim unerring. Ethan didn't concern himself with the other man any further once he'd ascertained he was still alive and fighting. Instead, he eyed the blonde woman he'd seen on the fourth floor. She'd taken up position on the other side of the garage to Ethan's left, sheltering behind a dusty sedan and joining her rifle fire with Dominic's. Ethan shook free from his rapid observations and squeezed the trigger of his own weapon, shooting an infected woman drawing too close to the blonde woman's position for his personal comfort.
We've got to get that gate closed,
Alicia suddenly said to his right. Ethan glanced at her and found that she'd joined him, her weapon raised. But she didn't fire any shots into the mass. Instead, her eyes were focused, laser-like, on the open gate. The chain that had held it shut had been strained to the breaking point. Its snapped ends dangled from the bottom of the gate.
If we can keep more from getting in, we can pick off what's left and then work on the others outside. Cut them off from the source, he said,
seeing the wisdom in Alicia's suggestion. An infected girl no older than 16, her face littered with piercings, snagged his arm. Ethan put the barrel of his gun against her forehead and squeezed the trigger. She fell back, sprawled limply on the concrete, and didn't move again. He gritted his teeth and forced his focus to the mess in front of him once again.
So how do you propose we get to the gate through these bastards?
He called over the gunfire echoing through the garage. Alicia hesitated, looking between him and the gate. An Asian man in a dirty business suit got uncomfortably close to them, and Ethan put a bullet in the man's skull. Uncertainty was a look that didn't suit Alicia's normally confident features, he reflected as he calmly grabbed an infected man by the arm and dragged him to the floor before shooting him in the face. They were on a battlefield. It wasn't the time or place for indecisiveness. Anger and irritation at her rose from his gut in a massive wave.
Oh, fuck it,
he snarled. He spared her a dirty look before turning on his heel and bolting in the direction of the gate. He ran right into the thickest part of the mass of infected trying to invade the Westin.
Alicia shouted as the stinking bodies of the infected closed in around him, but he couldn't make out her words. Nor did he care to. He had a more important task at hand, one entailing saving all their asses, since the ones in charge seemed too helpless to do it themselves. It was a stupid idea, though, he reflected as he jammed his Glock underneath a waitress's chin and squeezed the trigger before moving on to the next infected obstacle blocking his path. Alicia had all the ammunition. She hadn't bothered to give him so much as a spare magazine. It wouldn't be long before he ran out of what he had. And then, he'd be right back where he'd been just over a month before. Ethan couldn't spare time to think on that. Not right now. Not when he had a job to do. He plowed on, shoving and kicking and shooting his way through the infected, struggling past them toward the gate. Through its links, he saw the forms of more infected approaching the building. He had to put a stop to this before any more gained entry, or the building would never be secured again. And there was no way they could evacuate all these people safely. Ethan shoved his foot against the stomach of a large man grasping for him. The infected man was a behemoth, massively muscled and standing at least 6 inches taller than him. His stomach felt like it was made of solid stone. Despite that, the impact of his foot managed to force the man back several feet into the mass.
This bought Ethan enough time to lift his Glock again and plug a bullet into the large man's skull. He tumbled to the floor in a heap. The slide of his gun locked back.
He grimaced and jammed the weapon into the waistband of his jeans, since Alicia hadn't seen fit to give him a holster for it. Only one more infected man stood directly between him and the gate, though more still surrounded him on each side. Ethan waded through the infected, grasping at him, and reached the man in 3 long strides. He grabbed the man's shoulder and rammed the heel of his right hand against his nose. The cartilage shattered, driving into the man's brain, and he sagged against the gate and fell to the concrete. With the last of the immediate obstacles out of the way, Ethan threw himself at the gate, grasping it and slamming it to the floor. A hand caught between the gate and the concrete. Its owner, an elderly woman with 2 visibly broken legs, who clawed at his ankle. He gritted his teeth and grasped the gate more firmly, slamming it against her hand with all the strength in his body. Bones snapped, and with another strike, the appendage ripped free. Then, the gate fell fully shut.
"Where the fuck's my backup?"
he shouted over the din of infected echoing through the garage.
A thud against the gate pushed it an inch inward, jolting him forward.
He braced his heels on the concrete and pushed back, grasping at the gate tightly and nearly hanging off it to keep it closed. A snap of gunfire rang out to his left, and then Dominic was beside him, 2 thick lengths of chain in one hand and his rifle in the other. He slung the rifle's strap over his shoulder and slid the chains in place, wrapping them around and over and under the gate, and attaching them to anything that would hold them, including the large, thick pipes that ran along either side of the gate's entryway, before slapping padlocks into place. Then, still without speaking, he handed Ethan a fresh magazine of ammunition and moved away, raising his rifle again and firing into the remaining infected. The mop-up that followed was quick and brutal. Working methodically, the 4 of them swept the infected, goading them into corners of the garage or shoving them to the floor and firing bullets into their brains. Ethan felt robotic, almost mechanical, as he shot one after another, trying to shut down the part of his brain that screamed at his actions. It could have easily been him. The horror of the idea was too terrible to comprehend. He buried it and set about his uncomfortable work. It was only after he'd fired the last bullet in the last of the infected in front of him that he realized he was out of ammunition again. He lowered the weapon, his eyes locked onto the man spread-eagled on the concrete at his feet, and waved a hand at Alicia as the woman approached.
"Give me a new magazine," he demanded.
A last sporadic burst of gunfire punctuated the silence after his words.
"We're done, Ethan.
There aren't any more. We got them all, Alicia said. She stood silent for a moment, then lashed out, punching his shoulder right on top of one of his patched-up injuries. He flinched and sidestepped away from her.
What the fuck were you thinking running into the fuckers like that, huh? You could have gotten yourself killed!
He jammed the pistol back into his jeans waistband, striding across the garage to the door leading into the hotel proper. He skirted a few people emerging through the door as Alicia said something to Dominic. Then she hurried after him, still berating him as he shoved the door open.
You're fucking insane, you know that? Absolutely crazy! You're going to get one of us killed and... Shut the fuck up, Alicia!
Ethan snapped. He pulled the Glock from his jeans and turned on her. Her cheek twitched as she tried not to flinch at his sudden movement.
He shoved the sidearm toward her chest. Here, take the fucking thing.
Alicia took it and ran her fingers along the slide before ejecting the magazine, reloading it with bullets from her pocket as methodically as she'd shot the infected in the parking garage. Then she slapped the magazine back into the gun, chambered a round, and handed it back to Ethan, grip first, much to his surprise.
I think you've earned the right to carry this,
Alicia said solemnly. Then she pushed past him and stalked down the hall, quickly disappearing into the darkness. 1 month before the outbreak. Atlanta, Georgia. The bar Brandt walked into 10 minutes before his meeting with Dr. Derek Rivers immediately made him feel out of place and underdressed. He glanced down at his wrinkled, dirty jeans, his rumpled t-shirt, and his leather jacket, and wondered if it was too late to go home and change. But there wasn't enough time. The bar's hostess was already approaching him, her blue eyes sweeping over him from head to toe. She was pretty, maybe in her late 20s with thick blonde hair swept into an updo, her long, slim legs emerging from the short hemline of a slinky black dress. She had a menu in her hand, and she gave him a smile that revealed perfectly straight white teeth. She didn't appear to mind the fact that he was dressed in grunge wear in an upscale bar whose patrons wore suits and dresses.
Evening, sir,
she greeted. Judging by the gleam in her eyes, she liked what she saw.
What can I help you with this evening?
Brandt looked her up and down in a manner similar to what she'd done to him, trying to imagine her in bed with him. It wasn't hard. She was a beautiful woman, and she was clearly interested. However, he couldn't let his mind wander in that direction. There would be time for that later. First, he had important business to attend to. Mustering a smile, he said, I'm supposed to meet a Dr. Rivers. Do you know if he's here yet? The woman went back to the hostess stand and looked at the book on it, then nodded and beckoned to him.
Right this way,
she said, smiling and slipping out in front of him. She led him through the bar, sliding around tables, swaying her hips enticingly. Not that that was necessary. She'd already gotten his attention. She stopped beside a table close to the bar and indicated the man already sitting at it with a sweep of her hand.
Dr. Rivers, your guest is here.
Dr. Rivers was nothing like the image Brandt had built in his mind based off the voice on the telephone. He'd pictured an older man, a 30-plus-year veteran of the classroom with hunched shoulders, white hair, and glasses. The only thing he'd gotten right was the glasses. His sister Olivia's virology professor was a slender, well-built, dark-skinned man not much older than he was. If he had to guess, he'd placed Dr. Rivers in his early 50s, and when he stood and offered Brandt his hand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.